Harvest. How are you guys doing today? Good? Hey, why don't you guys go ahead and stand up? And we're going to prepare to worship the Lord this morning. But before we do that, I want to introduce a couple people that are here today. To my left, your right, this is Landon. And Landon has just joined staff here at Harvest as the associate worship pastor. So can you guys welcome him today? He's a great guy. We're really glad that you're here, Landon, and his wife, Mercedes. So you guys will be seeing them around here a lot more often. And then to my right, your left, this is Caleb. He's a friend that's visiting from Ohio. So would you guys welcome Caleb here today? Yes, yes, yes. Oh, we're going to pray before we begin. And as we're coming in and finding our place, I just want you guys to take a minute, take a breath. We're here together to worship the Lord. And I know that we come in and we come because we want to give the Lord praise, but we also come expecting him to work in our lives. We want to see him move. We need the Lord, so we come in dependence. So let's pray together and then we will begin in worship. Heavenly Father, we come in dependence and need of you. And so just right from the start of the service, We just say, Holy Spirit, come have your way in our hearts. Do the work that you need to do. We need you. And then we love you. We want to come because we want to devote our song and our minds and our hearts to you. And so, would our worship be a pleasing sound to you this morning? Pray this in your name. Amen. Amen. Let's worship.
What you church, we sing this.
Creator, sin, and flood on the cross of new.
true, Holy Spirit. We need more of you in our lives. And yet we know by those who have trusted and committed their lives to Jesus that we already have the gift of the Spirit. We have your presence with us. But we confess in the ways that we walk though without you. We confess the ways that we walk without the power of the Spirit, that we just try to walk this world on our own strength. And so when we sing, Holy Spirit, we want more of you. It's not that we're saying that you're not here with us, that you haven't made your home here with us. But we say that we need the truth that you bring to give us revelation of your word. We need the truth that you bring to give us wisdom. We need your working power, not our might, but your might. And so we just confess as a church the way that maybe we don't even know kind of what to make of you, Holy Spirit, and so we just don't do anything. But we worship you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And so we confess the ways that we don't lean on you and ask for more of you in our lives to fill us afresh. Give us fresh eyes to see your kingdom work. And so in our families, in our church, in our hearts, in our minds, Holy Spirit, come have your way. We need the supernatural help. So we're going to sing this together because we do need more of him in our lives. Let's sing. Holy Spirit. worship. Amen. Amen. Well, we're going to do one of my favorite things in our gatherings together, and that is to celebrate believers' baptism. And so really quick, you guys, when we baptize, it is not now that they are saved, but it is a public declaration of their commitment to follow Jesus. And so let's listen in and let's celebrate this morning's baptism. Oh, go ahead and have a seat.
Hey, Harvest, my name is Ramirez Moody. I'm the Associate Campus Pastor here at our Rolling Meadows campus, and I'm being joined today by Isaac Gonzalez and his father, Felipe. Isaac, why don't you share with us how life was before you surrendered it to Christ?
I grew up here at Harvest, and I had a family that loved God and just always had him in the house, but I never really put too much effort into that relationship, except going on like a Sunday, and that just led me to doing my own thing and being lost before I really surrendered.
Yeah. So it sounds like you had a knowledge of God, but you just didn't have a relationship with him. And so when did you surrender your life to Christ?
Well, it was earlier this year, and it was built up by me kind of doing my own things, and it led to me putting other things above God, whether it be relationships or whether it be whatever I wanted, it was above God. And finally, he said, it wasn't good, it was enough. And so it led to just a lot of pain and neglecting of, the people who cared about me most, most importantly, God. And that's when he showed me that I can't put anything above him, because there's nothing. I wouldn't have this life without him.
Yeah. Yeah, so it sounds like you were doing things in your own strength, and the Lord, through his grace and kindness, just brought you to the end of yourself, and you surrendered your life. And so how has your life been since then?
Oh, it's been so good. Amazing. Every day I wake up, I'm thankful for everything, and the big things, the small things, and just everything that's God set up for me. And for once in my life, I have a path, and he's lit it, and I know where to go. And no matter what I fall or mess up, he will be there to lift me up.
Right. Faith in Christ alone, right? So why are we here today? Why do you want to be baptized?
Well, first, it's for obedience. He calls us to be baptized, to be born again through the water, and that's what I'm going to do. And for display, just profess that Jesus saved me. He can save us all.
Yeah. Amen, man. Yeah. All right. Saving us, right? It's an ongoing process. All right, well, here, let's do that. Felipe, will you help me baptize your son this morning? All right. So, Isaac, it is by your, it is through your profession of faith in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that I now baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Well, praise God for that gift of salvation that is available to all. And welcome to Harvest. My name is John, and I serve as one of the pastors here. And I'm glad you're here today. We get to worship the Lord in spirit and truth. And if this is your first time, would you give me the opportunity just to get to know you a little bit after church? I'm going to be hanging out in the lobby. There's a banner that says welcome. We'd just love to meet you and find out if there's something I can do to help connect you in a greater way into our church. And I'll be hanging out there afterward. If you've been a part of Harvest for a bit, you know that we really try to connect with each other now and during the week. And one of the ways that we do that is through our app. And so if you have the app on your phone, I would encourage you to get that out and to check in. Maybe you could submit a prayer request. If here's what the Lord has pressed on my heart, would you pray for me this week? If you don't have the app, there's a QR code on a chair near you, and you can scan that, and it'll take you right to the app. So thanks for being here today, and we get to worship the Lord together in this place. Well, thinking about our church and the way that God is directing, that God is moving, and we want to invite you after the 11 a.m. service. So if you want to take off and get a little brunch and then come back, we'd love to have you be a part of our town hall. It's going to be in Cornerstone Cafe. Pastor Jeff and some of our leaders are just going to share some updates and give some information about where we're continuing to see God move in the days ahead. Amen. We've got a special conference set aside for you this coming Friday and Saturday. It's going to take place at the Rolling Meadows campus here. All of our campuses are coming here this Friday. So men of God, let's take a look.
All right, men, we are 1 week away from a men's conference that we are excited to have you join us. A lot of times guys get together and we watch sports or we do a bunch of other stuff and we talk about enjoyable nonsense, and we want to have the same kind of good time together, but we want to direct the conversation to some enjoyable some sense. We want to talk about living right side up in an upside down world, and you know that our world is upside down. You know that the way we think about things is not always the way that God thinks about them, so we want to reorient our minds, and we want to come together and think about things the way God has them. I'm speaking on Friday night, and then we've got a guest speaker on Saturday that you're really going to enjoy. A lot of hanging around, bags, tournaments, ping pong, I don't know, man, bacon. I'm sure there's a bunch of stuff that we can enjoy while we talk to each other about stuff that matters. Be there.
For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passion, to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age. In a world where everything is upside down, how do we live right side up?
Man, I really want to challenge you to be a part of this. Go to harvestbible.org to register. We have an opportunity as men of God to live in a way that pleases Him. And so I think you'll be really encouraged and challenged by this time together. You know, God's word has a lot to say about the way that we live our life. And Colossians chapter 3 speaks to not just how we live in the day, but how we even approach our giving. And so I'd love to read this verse for us. It says, "And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him." And whatever we do in word or deed, yeah, that's the way that we live during the week, but it's also in the way that we give. And there's a lot of ways that are listed on the screen that as we give to the Lord's work, that we would think about this as a heart posture, that we would be a grateful and thankful people for all He's done, for all the ways that He's provided, and He's gonna continue to do that because God's presence is with us. And so just want to encourage you as you, whenever it is that you give, or you give as you go out the door today, there's little blue boxes, we want you to think about thankfulness, gratefulness to the Lord for all that He has done. You know, this past week, it's been probably on all of our hearts, what's going on in Israel. And we're heartbroken and we're troubled over the conflict that's taking place, that this war that is raging has gripped the news, but it also is something that should be gripping our hearts and how we can be praying for Israel and all that they're going through. And God's word speaks to it. And I'd love to read Psalm 122, verses 6 through 9 together here. It says, "Pray for peace for Jerusalem. May they be secure who love you. Peace within your walls and security in your towers. For my brothers and companions' sake, I will say, peace be with you. For the sake of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your good." So I want to pray for our offering. I want to pray for the nation of Israel. I want to pray that God would do a work in the chaos that's taking place right now, and that those who are believers there would be able to see their opportunity to be the light for Christ, to come alongside people who are suffering. And so would you join me in prayer? Father in heaven, thank you for the many ways that you meet us right where we're at. And the days that are good, we are thankful and grateful, and we are reminded of your goodness. In the days of suffering, we're still reminded of your goodness and how much we need to cling on to you and hold fast to you. that we would be a people that are dependent and steadfast. And Lord, I pray for those who are believers in Israel today, that as they look at many of the things that are going on in their nation and the turmoil and the evil and the war that is raging, I pray that you would help them to be light in the darkness. I pray that you would help them when they see someone who's suffering to come alongside. I pray that you would help them when they see the message of hope that can be presented about Jesus, that they would do that in a way that's compelling to draw people to Jesus. And so, Lord, we are praying for this nation. We're praying for our believing brothers and sisters over there. Would you invigorate them? We're praying for the churches that are gospel churches, that you would use this in this day to bring yourself more glory. And so, Father, we thank you for the time that we have right now. We get to spend in your word. Would you use this passage to stir our hearts? Would you use this passage to call us into a greater work for you? And so we're thankful for this chance that we have now in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, before we get into God's word, we'll be looking at the book of Acts. I'd love to invite you to stand to your feet. And why don't you introduce yourself to somebody that you didn't come to church with today?
Hi, it's good to see you. Yeah. Most people clap when I leave. It's great seeing you. Listen, you need to have a Bible and you need to open it to Acts chapter 14. Acts chapter 14. We're going to look at the first 18 verses in this chapter today. It's a great story. Before we get into it, though, I wanted to tell you just it's a funny little story. Moms are great. I don't know if your mom was like this, but my mom, she didn't always connect all the dots. I don't know what it is. I just think that women have so much to think about that they don't follow sometimes the logic of some movies sometimes, and so you gotta stop and be like, what's happening? Okay, that guy, that guy, that guy, and then 5 minutes later, stop. So my wife's like that, my mother was like that, my sisters were like that. Anyway, I have a friend whose mom was very much like that, delightful, sweet, sweet woman. And they were watching Star Wars. So this is a long time. Well, they were watching on the TV, you know. They were watching Star Wars. I think it might have been The Return of the Jedi, but I don't know. Listen, you can write me later. That was the Empire Strike. Look, I don't know. But there's a scene. Do you know the saying in Star Wars, right? The Force be with you. There's a scene at the end of one of the movies where one of the spaceships comes down and it lands above this massive, trees everywhere, right? And my friend's mother leaned over to her and said, is that the forest? No? Right, the whole time she thought it was the forest is with you? No? Oh, there it is. Yeah. Oh, okay. You guys are like her, I guess. So misunderstandings, yeah? Sometimes they're funny. Oftentimes they get us into a lot of trouble if you act out on a misunderstanding. Sometimes you get yourself in a lot of relational difficulty. Almost every discussion I've had with my wife that has turned contentious has usually been over some misunderstanding on the meaning of what I said or what she said, and then we run with our conjecture or assumption about that. So misunderstandings kind of stink. This passage is about a massive misunderstanding. It's actually a pretty big misunderstanding regarding how it is that the people who hear the Apostle Paul and Barnabas, how they interpret who they are and what they're preaching about. I know that I've been showing maps at the beginning of most of these sermons. Again, I just want to show you that we're not in Narnia. We're talking about actual places. And so this is their mission trip, first mission trip of any couple of people or any group of people that has ever been sent out from a local church. The church called Syrian Antioch purposely sends out these missionaries, and they make their tour. Eventually, they go to an island called Cyprus, which is down here, and then they come up to this mainland. What you're going to see is that Paul came up here, he preached in the synagogue there in Pisidian Antioch, and then he makes this tour down here to Iconium, and then to Lystra, and to Derbe. This area here, very important, is not on the beaten path. It's out of the way. It's the country folk in that part. So what we're going to do in Acts 14 is see how it is that the gospel is preached to people who are not the city slickers. We're going to see how the message changes a little bit. Paul's not going to quote the Old Testament at all, but he is going to cite some things that God has communicated to these people that maybe they'd not noticed before. So look, let's jump into it in Acts 14. I want to tell you the story, so I'll do a little outline. We're going to tell you the story, and then I've got two applications at the end, okay? But I want to tell you the whole story so you get the feels for it first. Here's Acts 14, verse 1. Now at Iconium, remember I drew that little line down. So he's going down to Iconium. This was actually a significant city, Iconium was. So it was on the beaten path. So lots of folks there, a large Jewish community in Iconium. And so it makes sense that Paul would go, and the first place that he would go and he would preach would be in the synagogue. At Iconium, they entered together into the Jewish synagogue. And they spoke in such a way that a great number of both Jews and Greeks believed. Remember, in the synagogues, there were Jewish people who were, of course, there. And then there were the Greeks, the Gentile God-fearers who were kind of in the back row, who were interested in Israel's God, but didn't have all the access that a Jewish person would have religiously. And so he gets a hearing and belief among both Jews and Greeks. But the unbelieving Jews, they stirred up the Gentiles. So this is probably a reference to the Gentiles who ran the city. The unbelieving Jews stirred up the Gentiles and poisoned their minds against the brothers. So they remained for a long time, because that's what you do, right? You remain for a long time when people are poisoning the minds of others about you. Well, I mean, I don't. You probably don't. You and I, if somebody's really mad at you, you're like, I'm out of here, right? Pearls before swine, that kind of stuff. But apparently they were like, no, the presence of persecution and difficulty is a sign that we are over the target. And so they keep going. They stick around for a long time, speaking boldly for the Lord. And the Lord bore witness to the word of his grace. So the proclamation of the gospel they're giving is what they call the word of his grace. And the way that God attended that word was that he granted signs and wonders. Now, in the rest of the book of Acts, one of the things that we learn is that signs and wonders is shorthand for basically a deliverance from demon possession and healing people of physical distress. Both. So these guys come into the city, they're proclaiming the gospel. Some people believe. Others don't. The ones who don't get angry. This is a pattern you'll see. They raise up some persecution, but while this is happening, it's very difficult for a lot of people in the city to make a decision conclusively about these guys because they're doing these remarkable things. You know, the person that you've known for all these years who's had that infirmity has been healed by the touch of these men who claim that the power is from the Jesus they preach. So they're not sure what to do about it. The people of this city were divided. Some sided with the Jews who were saying, you know what, it's not a big deal. Don't believe your lying eyes. They don't have power. Maybe they have the power, as they accused Jesus, through the power of Satan. And it's not the power of God in them. They sided with some of the Jews, and some sided with the apostles. But when an attempt was made by both Gentiles and Jews with their rulers, right? You always got to go to the authorities and tell on them because you yourself can. Citizens arrest. It's not probably going to work. So you go and you get the authorities to come in. And they made an attempt to mistreat them and to stone them. They learned of it. And look at this time. They fled to Lystra. So I guess sometimes when persecution arises, you stick around, and sometimes you're like, nah, no thanks. I know some missionaries, this is like a major portion of what they have to think through because the areas they're in, sometimes I know some people who work in northern India, and there are militant Hindus there, and they're always trying to figure out whether or not do we stay and preach boldly for a long period of time, right? Because Paul and Barnabas did that. But also Paul and Barnabas fled, so it's a hard decision that you've got to make. They choose to flee on the second occasion. And they go to Lystra and Derbe. And like I said, these are not along the important path places. This is not along I-90. This is, in fact, Lystra is a day's journey off the main road. So the only people who went to Lystra meant to go to Lystra. Maybe you have a cousin or something who lives off the beaten path. And when you drive down to Alabama on the highway, and then you have to take a turn, and you get off the beaten path. Funny story, when I was in Alabama, I love off the beaten path, right? Because you get to go in the hole-in-the-wall restaurants, and my kids think I'm ridiculous for it, but I don't care. So we go off the beaten path, and we were driving around, and we went to a town called Greenville, Alabama, and there's all the stores were closed, everything, but the original Piggly Wiggly was in Greenville, Alabama, and I'm like, that's worth driving. So we drove a good 30 minutes off the main road, and we get to the original Piggly Wiggly, and I'm walking around in the original Piggly Wiggly, and I'm buying Piggly Wiggly stuff, and the manager's talking to me about the history of this here Piggly Wiggly. Went to the front counter, and there's this girl there who, she's probably in her early 20s, and she looked so downtrodden. And I said, isn't this great? This is the original Piggly Wiggly, I said to her. My boys were like, Dad, don't talk to the girl. And I said, this is the original Piggly Wiggly. And she said, I didn't know that. And I said, yeah, you do. It's in Greenville, Alabama. She said, where are you from? And I said, well, actually, at that point, we're from Canada. And she said, why on earth would you ever come to Greenville, Alabama? I've spent my life trying to leave Greenville, Alabama. By the way, I loved Greenville. I thought it was great. Apparently, she didn't think so great. That's Lystra. That's what this town is. Lystra, Derbe, cities of Lyconia, and to their surrounding, and yeah, this is the right word, country. And there they continue to preach the gospels. And we're in a different kind of location now. And so they ran away, and they've gone to locations where probably they're not going to be followed. At least that's the assumption. They're not going to be followed there, so they can have some freedom to do gospel preaching. Now, at Lystra, there was a man sitting who could not use his feet. This is actually really important that he could not use his feet. The reason it's important is because if you were from a small town, some of you are from small towns, you know every person in that small town who had some sort of infirmity from birth, yes? Like you knew Johnny is deaf. He's been deaf his whole life. Everyone knows Johnny is deaf. It was a small town that I worked in for a while, and there's a young guy there who rides a three-wheel bike all around town. Everybody in Colfax, Washington knows the kid who rides the three-wheel bike. They know his name. They know everything about him. This is why some people like the small town, right? And we in the city, we think about small towns, and we're like, wouldn't it be great to be known by everyone? And everyone in the small town's like, no, it's not. They're all up in your business all the time. And right. Because the community is smaller, and you know everything that's happening. And so look, let's not just think this is some rando sitting on the side of the road who nobody knew about. No, this man who couldn't use his feet was well known to everyone. They knew his backstory. They knew that he was unable to walk for his whole life. He was crippled, in fact, from birth and had never walked. He listened to Paul speaking. And Paul, very important here, looking intently at him. This is the second time that Paul looks intently at somebody in this book. The last time it was to tell some guy who is objecting to his message and trying to win the ear of a local ruler. Paul looked at him intently and said, "You son of the devil." So look, if Paul looks at you intently, something crazy is going to happen. Paul, looking intently and seeing that he had faith to be made well, he said in a loud, commanding, declarative voice, "Stand upright on your feet." And he sprang up and he began walking, something he'd never done in his entire life. He started walking around. Just so you know, I found a picture of where Lystra is. If you go there today, that's what it looks like. So yeah, not well developed. And it wasn't in those days either. So when the crowd saw what Paul had done, they lifted up their voices, saying in Lyconian, they used their common, their local dialect. That's what people in smaller towns do, right? I mean, the rest of the world's speaking Greek, but we're still holding on to our local language, lest it be lost. So they speak to one another in Lyconian. "The gods have come down to us in the likeness of man." Barnabas they called Zeus and Paul Hermes. Zeus and Hermes, because Hermes or Paul was the chief speaker. Zeus, do you guys remember high school? Some of you, you're like, "I tried to forget about it." Look, remember Zeus is the guy who's the head of the entire Greek Greco-Roman pantheon, and he's got a big lightning bolt in his hand. He's the leader god. And he has a messenger. He's a lightning bolt because you better do what Zeus says or you're going to get the lightning bolt. Hermes was his messenger. He was the guy who went around and did the bidding of Zeus and reported things to other people, delivered messages. So these guys show up and these people think that this is Zeus, Barnabas, who's standing kind of behind, not saying as much, but looking authoritative, I suppose. And Paul, who's speaking, so he must be the one who's speaking on behalf of Zeus. Why in the world would anyone think these guys are gods? So here's the crazy part about this. Here's some background that you need to know. In the first century, there was a story. In fact, it was a poem. And it was by a guy named Ovid, which is a great name for your kids if you're thinking about names here today. Ovid. The name of the poem was Metamorphoses. In the poem, it's about how Zeus and Hermes take on human form and come down to a small-ish town. And in this smallish town, they go door to door, knocking on everyone's door, asking for some hospitality, some help. We need a place to stay. Everybody has a reason why it is that Zeus and Hermes can't come in. They don't know Zeus and Hermes. They're just two dudes who are coming to the door. And they're like, "Listen, we can't. We don't have room. We're just busy." Whatever. All the reasons. They go to 1,000 doors. Finally, they go to the door of this old couple. They knock on the door. And this old couple, they invite them in. "Finally, come in. We have a place for you. We will make sure that you're taken care of." So they stay there that night. Well, the next morning, around breakfast, these gods reveal their godhood. And this couple, of course, is stunned, and the gods say, "Come with us." And they go to the top of a hill, and they're looking down at the entire town. And looking down at the town, Zeus calls in a flood, and the whole town is flooded in judgment for their lack of hospitality. As for the old couple, their home, the dilapidated old house turned into a temple of marble. And the moral to the story is, be kind to people who show up at your door because they might be gods in disguise. And there'll be rewards if you treat them well and judgment if you do not. First century, that poem was popular, went around. We got some copies of it, in fact. So here come these two guys showing up to a small town. Paul, when he gets a chance, he looks at this guy who everyone knows has been crippled since birth. He looks at the guy, he looks intently at him, and then he speaks in a godlike voice. Stand up! And he stands and he starts walking around. And then everyone's like, who do you think this is? Well, of course they know who it is. They're not gonna be fooled. They don't want their town to get flooded. And so, listen, it's Zeus and it's Hermes. So the priest of Zeus, whose temple was at the entrance of the city, he brought oxen and garlands. You know, that's the sign that they're the good ones. Here, bring the important oxen and put some wreaths around their neck. They brought them to the gates and they wanted to offer sacrifice with the crowds. Of course you want to offer sacrifice with the crowds. There's a lot at stake here. Well, the apostles, Barnabas and Paul, they heard of it. And they tore their garments, which is, listen, people who are in the Mediterranean world are the awesome people in the world. They're not British. You know, British are like, don't ever let them see you sweat. Stiff upper lip. They're like, no, let them see what's going on inside by acts that you do outside. So when they tear their clothes in the Bible, they're basically saying, I'm ripped up inside. I saw this video effect of a guy who was golfing the other day, and he got in a fight with some other golfers, and they were standing by their carts, and he wouldn't move. He wouldn't budge in terms of his viewpoint. And finally, it was escalating, and then he pulls his shirt off, and he goes, come on, right? Right, we do it. Right? I'm so mad. Here we go. I don't need anything. We're going to fight. I don't want anything getting in my way. Tore their garments. Rushed out into the crowd, crying out, what are you doing? Look, we are also men of like nature with you. And look, we bring you good news. That you should turn from, note it, these vain things to a living God. You know, when he says these vain things, he's referring to their religion. Guys, it's empty. What you're doing is empty. You're calling on a God who doesn't exist. You're assuming that we are gods who actually don't exist. There's only one living God, and we bring you good news from that living God. So you know, those of you who know your Bibles or remember stories in the scriptures, remember that Elijah in the Old Testament, he gets into this competition between him and the prophets of Baal, or 400 prophets of Baal. And Elijah says, finally, look, everyone's divided in their opinion. Why don't we get to have a competition on the top of the hill? And you guys, 400 prophets, will dance around the altar and you'll pray that your God will bring down, you know, fire from heaven. And then I will get up and I will pray to my God and we'll see which God answers. And so the prophets of Baal start in the morning and they're around the, slashing themselves around the altar, beating their chests. So Baal, answer us. About, you know, mid-morning after they've been doing it for an hour and a half, Elijah's over in the corner and he starts mocking them by saying, you should probably talk louder. He's probably on vacation. You should yell louder. He's in the toilet. Literally, he actually says that to them. He's going to the bathroom. He can't hear you. What's he doing? Well, he's mocking him because he's not worried that the gods are going to answer because they don't exist. This is his whole point. You guys serve a dead God. But I'm here serving the living God. And Paul says the same thing. You look, turn away from all this stuff. Serve the living God who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and all that's in them. In past generations, he allowed the nations to walk in their own ways. Yet he did not leave himself without witness. It's not like your lives, I'm just coming to you and introducing you to a God who's never shown himself to you before. In fact, your whole lives, he says, have been inundated with evidence of this God's care and love for you. Even though you blasphemed him by turning away to idols and things that are not, this God has shown you care. How? He did you good by giving you rains from heaven and fruitful seasons. All of the prosperity that you've experienced in your life, every last solitary thing, whether you are a faithful follower of God or somebody who doesn't believe God exists at all, it's all a product of his kindness to you. He's given you everything you need. The markets have risen. They go down from time to time, but you have a house because of him. You have a car because, that's his argument here. Everything around you is a testimony. It's a screaming, testifying act of God saying, I've been good to you. He's given you rains from heaven and fruitful seasons. He's satisfied your hearts with food and gladness. Every single day of your life when you eat, he says, God is saying something to you. Even with these words, though, they scarcely restrained the people from offering sacrifice to them. This is, I mean, the end of this is really great, right? Because you're like, these guys are like, okay, but you're probably still just lying to us. Get more oxen. It's a misunderstanding, right? All right, so what do we learn? A couple things. Number one is a very theological thing. And it is this. Other religions don't stack up. I actually think that this passage gives you and I clear indication of the way that followers of Jesus Christ in a pluralistic, that means in a many-religioned society, should think of those many religions. There's a question that arises sometimes in theological circles, and it's this. If there are people who are far, far away and have never heard the gospel of Jesus Christ, what do we say about them? Can they be saved apart from explicit personal knowledge of Jesus and the gospel? And the answers to those questions usually come from Christians, well, not from religious people anyway, come in three categories. The people who believe that there is a God will end up saying, well, one of the answers is what they call pluralism. And pluralism is the belief that, look, all of these religions, all of them are equal ways to seek the divine. And people use the image of, you know, the top of Mount Everest, there are several. You can go to the north face, you can go to the south face, you can go. There's lots of ways up there. And that's basically what all the religions in the world are, just different ways for you to get up to God. But Allah, Vishnu, Buddha, what, Yahweh, all basically the same. I mean, in order to get there, you got to remember that you kind of have to squint, because if you get too close to those religions, you'll be like, I don't know. But everyone, doesn't matter. You're just responding. And you can, I mean, everyone's going to end up with God as long as they have pursued him in whatever form they want. So pluralism. There's a second viewpoint that has become really popular among a lot of Christians, and it's called inclusivism. And inclusivism is the belief that, yeah, okay, look, we know Jesus died for the sins of the world, but his death is applied not just to people who have personal faith in Jesus, because not everybody has gotten that revelation. It's applied to anybody who has responded rightly to whatever revelation they have. So if you're a Buddhist and you've never heard the gospel and you're being a faithful Buddhist, you're actually an anonymous Christian. And God will count your faithful Buddhism as an appropriate response to him, and he will say, had I gotten the gospel to you, you would have responded rightly. So all the religions of the world, if you have faithful adherence to the religions of the world, those people are actually actively pursuing whatever light they've got, and as a result, they are Christian, albeit anonymous Hindu. And then there's the, man, that is a horrible inclusivism, my word. The last one is called particularism. Well, some people call it exclusivism, but that sounds mean. So the people who hold it were like, we like particularism better. And the idea is, look, there is a particular way that God has chosen to be accessed. There is a single way. God could have chosen that all religions of the world would lead to the same thing, but he didn't choose that. He chose a particular way. What is that particular way? Well, the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that there is no salvation apart from explicit, personal knowledge of Jesus. Now you can understand why this has come under massive scrutiny. This is a viewpoint of the Christian church for lots and lots of ages, but you can understand why it comes under massive scrutiny, because it's like, well, wait a minute. There's 99.9% of the people in Afghanistan don't know the name of Jesus. And you're saying that they're all destined for an eternity away from Christ in judgment? This sounds way better. At least that means that everyone can be included into things. But here's the question, okay? Here's the question. So there's the theological viewpoints, but here's the question you have to ask yourself. What was Paul and Barnabas's view? Because what you have in this story is you have a bunch of people who are really being faithful to the revelation they've been given in Zeus and Hermes and the Roman pantheon. They are really committed to worshiping any evidence that these gods have come to earth. And when they start worshiping, what do Paul and Barnabas do? Do they stand out and go, well, good for you. That's fantastic. You've responded to the light you've been given. No, they rip their clothes because they're like, this isn't good enough. This is not the way it works, because God has commanded you. He left the nations on their own at one point, but now he's commanding you to repent. I bring you good news. Turn from these vain things to the living God. Now look, I have lots and lots of other reasons why I think that that's the way we ought to view this. Some of them are the fact that in Scripture, you actually get pretty consistently the testimony that the only way somebody can be saved is through explicit faith, personal faith in Jesus. So here, Acts 4:10, Paul or Peter is preaching to the Jewish people, the Sanhedrin. They're people who've actually responded very well to the Judaism in front of them. Let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel, but by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, by him, this man, he had healed a guy there, by him, this man is standing before you well. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. It's one way. It's through this Jesus and your acceptance of him. And yes, you've been God, you're God's people, and he chose you as a nation. But this is the dividing line. There's a true Israel. And the true Israel are those who are in Christ and have received him as their Messiah. So only one way. John 14, Jesus himself, in my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, that where I am, you may also be. And you know the way to where I'm going. And Thomas, God bless him, said, Lord, look, I don't know. What are you talking about? We don't know the way to where you're going. How could we know the way? And Jesus said, I am, note it, the way. I am the truth. I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. It's one road that leads to the top of Mount Everest. And over that road is written Jesus. One more, just for fun. I brought this up a couple of weeks ago. Everyone who calls, Paul writes in Romans, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. So you have to call on the name of the Lord. You remember this? How then will they call on him? See, how will they call on him whom they not believe? So you need to believe to call. And how are they to believe in him of whom they've never heard? You need to hear so you can believe. And how are they to hear without someone preaching? You're going to preach so they can hear. And how are they to preach unless they are sent? You see this? In order for people to call upon the name of the Lord Jesus, by the way, explicit faith, personal faith in Jesus Christ. If, in order for somebody to call in the name of the Lord, they need to be sent so they can preach, so people can hear and they believe and they call. So what we're left with is this hard truth. Billions engage in empty worship to dead gods. If there's no response to the gospel, they'll be eternally lost. Now, I gotta tell you, if you let that sit with you enough and you end up saying, all right, I'm willing to submit to the authority of God himself as he's spoken in his word, okay? I'm gonna submit to that. Here's what should go on in your heart. One of these three things should go on in your heart. One, we've gotta go and tell. Right? I mean, this, we're not talking about just, hey, man, you get some extra happy life here and better, you know, God makes you good at life and he makes life good. We're not talking about that. What we're talking about is eternity. So we end up saying, look, we've got to go and tell. We have to do whatever it takes that the nations might hear. Our money, our time, our effort, our prayer, all of those things should be focused on saying, Lord, help the nations know. Help the people in our community know. So go and tell. Second, you could say, well, I'm not gonna be able to go and tell in terms of the nations. I haven't been placed in my own little area of life, but in, as far as the nations go, I can't go and tell. But what I can do is I can pray and give that others might go. It is a sad state of affairs that in the world today, one of the reasons that we don't have missionaries is because we don't have people to back the missionaries. What in the world? There is so much money in the Christian church globally that if we were just to give a portion of what we have for the reaching of the lost in the nations, we'd have plenty of folks, but so here's the third option. Just think about other things. I mean, we could invest in our comfort, buy the new and improved thing, whatever it is. Think about our next holiday, vacation. Think about what we're looking forward to. Think about all the stuff. Inebriate our minds. Because it's hard to dwell on that kind of thing. We could absolutely flatter other faiths. We could end up going and saying, isn't it neat that you have a moral life? And what I like about you is that you're a good person. We could say that, but instead of thinking what Paul and Barnabas think, which is like, guys, dead faith, vain, dead God. Yeah, we could absolutely just pass by the guy on beaten on the side of the road. But here's the thing. Here's the thing. I will bet you that those who eventually believed the gospel in Lystra were glad Paul and Barnabas didn't choose that third option. I mean, there are thousands, dare I say millions, of people who could be reached by the sacrifices of Harvest Bible Chapel. Jeff, that sounds really mean. Like, particularism, you just changed it from exclusivism because it sounds horrible. Exclusivism. God is, you're making it sound like God is a limiting God. You're making it sound like he's got not the best in mind for everyone. Right, so here's my last point. God is good all the time. So in this passage, one of the things that you realize that's the main thrust of Paul's sermon is God's always been good to you. Whether you're somebody who thinks God's great or thinks don't even think he exists, God has been great to you. Everything in your life is a testimony of the greatness of God and the kindness of God to you, the goodness of God to you. You ever thought about how good God's been to you? So I wasn't supposed to have a third child. In fact, the way it worked with my wife and I, we are betting 3 out of 5. Our first was a miscarriage, early miscarriage. The second was my oldest son. The third was my second son. And then the fourth was a late miscarriage. So I'm supposed to have a child between my Micah and my Sophie. We were devastated when that happened. Went to the doctor. And the doctor said, I'm surprised you guys have any kids at all. You're not supposed to have kids. So it's a bit of a miracle you have children. And so that was hard for us to come to, you know, come to the realization that, all right, Lord, this is what you have for us. You know, I'm the guy who wants to have like 12 kids. My wife, not so much. I want the 12 kids. You know, like, how hard is it anyway? I mean, come on, I've had a cold. I'm kidding. Come on. Don't write me an email about that, please. It's just a joke. All right. So I came home one day, and my wife had, she had waited to go to the doctor, missed her time of the month and everything, and had waited because she was like, surely not, surely not, surely not. She'd waited quite a while and didn't really said anything to me. And then she went to the doctor, kind of on her own, and says, so what's going on? And they took a pregnancy test, and she, yes. And they did a little ultrasound there. So when I came home, I didn't know any of this. I came home, she handed me a box. And in the box was the positive pregnancy test, which I was like, I don't know, you have COVID? I don't know. So I took the pregnancy test, or I looked at it, and I didn't know really what it was. And then on the top, she had a little card. And in it said, roses are red, violets are pink, and that's a color you better get used to. Because we're having a daughter. Oh, right? So we had Sophie, and she is such a delight. And I remember when she was maybe 2, I would come home from work, and I would come to the bottom of our stairs, and I would look up to the top, and whenever I came home from work, she'd come to the top of the stairs, and she'd do a twirl, and she'd, daddy, 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 daddy. Like this little song that she would sing. And I would stand at the bottom of the stairs and I would say, oh God, you're so good. I went to the College World Series this last year. My son plays for Louisiana State University. And they made it to the College World Series. They won it. They won the College World Series. But you know, the way it went, you cheer for teams, right? That are good, but never good enough. Right? All you Packer fans, you know what I'm talking about, right? Right? You're like, they're good this year. They're always good. Yeah. Not good enough. Right? And you Bear fans, you don't know what I'm talking about. But in the 80s, they were good. Okay? But you know, most of our lives, we spend cheering for teams that will never win. That don't win. Okay. So I didn't expect my sons, even though they were highly ranked and stuff, they get to the College World Series, and then they they're in the tournament. They lose to the newest, highest-ranked team, Wake Forest, and we're like, ah, bummer, but it's a double elimination tournament. And so they come back around, and they play Wake Forest in order to go to the final of this tournament. And they're playing, and it's 11 innings, and nobody scored until this dude, Tommy, he stands up to bat. They put in their new superstar relief pitcher. He throws one pitch, and Tommy hits it over the left field wall. I am telling you right now, I barely remember this because I was nearly passing out because I was so enraptured. I had to hold the seat in front of me and like, where am I? Honey, could not believe it. They went on. They ended up beating Florida in the final. Take that, Florida. Anyway, they won it in the final. I remember walking away from them and said, this never happens. Look, you're so good. You're so good. Did you know that I drove? Have you driven in Illinois before? Because I'm shocked we're all here. It's amazing to me that you made it here today. Amazing to me that I made it here today. I go home and I'm like, I made it. My car started when I got out there today. I drove here. I didn't get pulled over. My car didn't break down. I arrived in one piece. I showed up. I drank a Diet Mountain Dew, which was just there for me. You know, we don't think about any of these things. My heart is beating. My brain's mostly working. I mean, we don't think about all the stuff. You know why? Because it happens so regularly that we end up thinking, oh yeah, sure, God's good, but he's not good in these three areas, right? We're the people who stand and look at the majesty of what God's provided us. We're like the people who are standing looking at the most magnificent view anyone's ever seen. And we stand out there, and in the periphery of our vision are two lone trees. And we're like, this is a great view, except for those trees. I hate those trees. What shall we do with those trees? These trees are evil. Honey, do you see the trees? And she's like, no, I see the whole... Look over here, it's right here. Let's talk about the trees. Whose trees are they? We should chop the trees down. Our whole lives should be wrapped up in those trees. But should it? Yeah, there are trees. Of course there are trees in the view. There are all sorts of things. There will be a day there won't be any trees in the view. But I'm telling you, between now and then, the goodness of God is before you in all its majesty. Which means, number one, if you're not a Christian or somebody who's just, as we say, kicking the tires on Christianity or church, can I challenge you with something? I know the viewpoint around our society is that God's mean and he's limiting and all these sorts of things. Is he? You're here. The message of the gospel is that Jesus has died for your sins and you can be eternally free.